To kick off this evening's proceedings, I'm really delighted. This event this evening is a jointly hosted with the Law School of Western Sydney University and the Whitlam Institute within this university. And so I'd invite Professor Michael Adams, who's the Dean of Law, to provide the acknowledgement to country and welcome.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to have you on our campus tonight. This land that we're on belongs traditionally to the Darug people. I'm concentrating hard because we're so used to saying UWS or University of Western Sydney, so we're still getting used to our new name of Western Sydney University. Takes our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander family very seriously. And in fact, in this building, we house our Pro Vice Chancellor, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders, Professor Myuran, who was in fact the first graduate Aboriginal person from Harvard University with a PhD. And she's giving a lot of guidance on the direction of the university in Aboriginal aspects. And she will in fact be moving, holding that position for until the end of the year. So we're on Darug people's land, and it is important to acknowledge their history. And this building, I guess, has itself a tremendous history. You're in one of the oldest three-storey buildings in Australia that's gone through a number of changes, and the university itself is very proud of how we've put it together. And this evening, I have to say I'm very excited to think that the Whitlam Institute and the School of Law have come together with an opportunity with some very fine speakers, two from the School of Law, and of course the Honourable Barry Jones giving different perspectives. So officially, on behalf of the university, on behalf of the School of Law and the Whitlam Institute, enjoy the proceedings. Eric, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. This evening's topic, of course, is one of those that is almost a perennial. The question of the death penalty and its abolition has occupied minds for a long time, and of course those of us who have been involved in various ways for its abolition have been preoccupied with it for decades. I don't know the content of Barry's speech, but it is worth noting that it's a case study, the death penalty in this country at least, in terms of the longevity and persistence that's required to actually embed social change. In fact, the first motion from opposition to abolish the death penalty in federal crimes was from Gough Whitlam in opposition in 1960. And I won't go through the chronology, but it's extraordinary that it was almost 50 years exactly before the last vestiges were eliminated from our own statutes. So it's an important topic. The amazing thing, of course, is that it's not just an important topic, it's a current topic. As we discovered last year, as we know from developments in our own region and indeed developments internationally, and as we may discover this evening, it's not necessarily an issue without hope, because we have come a very long way. In structuring this evening's conversation, of course, there was one person that for us of a certain vintage had to be here, and that was the Honourable Barry Jones. Barry, of course, as many of us know, is genuinely one of the great figures of Australian public life, one of the great intellects of Australian public life. I could go through his resume and where do you start and where do you finish. Multiple author, the only person, one of the very few people, I think, Barry, what did you just tell us, of all four wings of the Academy?
Only one.
Only one. All four branches of the Australian Academy of Social Sciences recognises Barry Jones. He's been a minister, he's been a quiz champion, he's been a teacher, he is a continuing author and is working on his latest book even now. But for myself, and I think I first met Barry, must have been about 1981, I think, Barry, when we first met. Barry was very much the figure that inspired us in the campaign to abolish the death penalty in this country from the time of Ronald Ryan, the last execution in 1967, and I can only say it is our great, great privilege to welcome the Honourable Barry Jones to this evening's forum.
Well, Eric and Dean and friends, thank you very much for the invitation. I've been asked to talk about the death penalty, and I'll try and keep myself strictly to time, about the death penalty in Australia in a political context. And I suppose my fundamental thesis, not a particularly original one, is that imposing the death penalty is always a political act. Governments don't do it unless they want to make a political statement of some sort. If I could quote the Canadian philosopher Ronald Wright, who argues, states arrogate to themselves the power of coercive violence, the right to crack the whip, execute prisoners, send young men to the battlefield. From this stems what J.M. Coetzee, you know, the great Nobel Prize-winning novelist now living in Adelaide, Coetzee has called the black flower of civilization: torture, wrongful imprisonment, violence for display, the forging of might into right. States employ various styles of human sacrifice as forms of the ultimate political theatre. Interesting to just give a bit of an overview of how the death penalty operated in Australia from the very earliest times. The Aborigines had a tradition of ritual spearing in retaliation for an injury, but execution as a ritual began with European intervention. And it began a long time ago when seven Dutch mutineers, some of them murderers as well, survivors of the sinking of the Batavia, were hanged by the Dutch East India Company on Seal Island in the Houtman and Broilus Islands off the coast of Western Australia in October 1629. So it's a long time ago. First execution after British settlement took place in Sydney on the 27th of February 1788, when Thomas Barrett, aged 17, was hanged for theft barely a month after the first fleet arrived. So they had their own sense of priorities, and they wanted to get in early. The best calculation seems to have been that since European settlement in 1788, there have been a total of about 2,050 people executed in Australia. But you'd have to say that about 400 were executed in that early period between 1788 and 1819. Then, in the 80-year period between 1820 and 1900, in that 80-year period, you had, considering the small population, you had a total of 1,530 executions. Then, you get into the 20th century, between 1901 and 1940, there were 94 executions, so it's a rapid falling away. Then from 1941 to 1967, there were 21 executions. And of course, since 1967, none at all. Now, the Labour Party was very early in determining to abolish the death penalty. It took a long time before it succeeded, but in Victoria, for example, it was part of Labour Party policy as early as 1898. And that meant that whenever Labour governments, in most states, whenever Labour governments were in power, they didn't execute. Labour Party's record is a bit spotty in this, because there are a couple of exceptions. In Western Australia, where, as you know, news takes several hours to get over there, but in Western Australia, under the Collier Labour government, there were a couple of executions. And in New South Wales, during the war, during the First World War, under the Holman government, there were a couple of executions because people were then thought to be terrorists. There were a couple of places blown up, and it was assumed that the people were terrorists. So that was regarded as quite exceptional. I mean, the language is something you'd be quite familiar with in view of what's been happening in recent times. But gradually, over the years, the Labour Party, when it was in power, was able to legislate to abolish the death penalty, beginning, believe it or not, in Queensland. The last execution in Queensland was over a century ago, in 2013, and the death penalty was actually abolished as early as 1922. So Queensland, long way ahead of any of the other states. New South Wales followed, sort of, in 1950. Their last execution in New South Wales, 1940. The death penalty for murder was abolished in 1955. But what happened was that when they passed the legislation in 1955, there was a curious lapse of memory, and they realised that they hadn't abolished it for all offences. And it still remained on the statute books for treason, piracy, and arson in dockyards. And, of course, supporters of the death penalty would say, well, in the that 30-year period, the incidence of those crimes was very low. So clearly the death penalty must have had a deterrent effect. Anyway, after 30 years, they realised with some embarrassment that they hadn't cleaned up their act, and so it was removed. Tasmania abolished it in 1968. Labor had an execution in 46, but you have to say, under the Hare Clark system and in an election year, that you can't be too careful. So the result is that they thought it was worth executing a prisoner because they thought it would help them get re-elected, and it did. The last Commonwealth execution was in 1952, up in the Northern Territory. And then, as you know, the Whitlam government abolished the death penalty in 73. South Australia and Western Australia had their last hangings in 64, and they abolished the death penalty, respectively, in 1976. In Western Australia, it wasn't abolished till 1984. But it's interesting. Very often, decisions about what you're going to do and what you're not going to do depends very much on the temperament of individual leaders. Mm-hmm. And in the case of Sir Charles Court, who, of course, was the Liberal leader in Western Australia, but he was known to have very deep sense of unease about the death penalty, although he was the Premier for a very long time. And he didn't initiate legislation to abolish the death penalty. Nevertheless, he didn't allow the death penalty to be executed in his time. And then, of course, came 1967 with the execution of Ronald Ryan, the last person to be hanged in Australia. And I was, I suppose, a kind of central figure in the long campaign for the abolition of the death penalty. And then, remarkably, you see, when Bolte retired, you had a premier, Dick Hamer, with a completely different mindset. And Hamer had always been deeply uneasy about the death penalty. And the result was that he introduced legislation. He had a big majority, conservative majority, and he insisted on having a free vote. While Labor people essentially exercised a tied vote, there were enough people who supported Hamer personally to let the legislation through. Since I mentioned Hamer, I can't help repeating the familiar story about Hamer the revered E.G. Whitlam, because you may know, as Gough used to tell the story, they both came from Kew in Victoria. And as Gough used to say about Dick Hamer, said, we were born, he said, in the same month, in the same year, in the same suburb. Different fathers. Well, different mothers too, if it comes to that, but certainly different fathers. So the result is that, but you'd have to say, I think it's fair to say that the Labor Party's had, there's been a certain amount of hypocrisy, I think, sometimes about the way in which the death penalty has been administered. And even the Labor Party's record, as I said before, isn't altogether perfect. And something that's not particularly perfect is I can't find... Oh, yes, there we are. Whoops. No, I was going to say that that one of the great problems, I think, so far as Australia is concerned about the death penalty has been that sometimes we've been quite inconsistent the way in which we've approached the death penalty. In other words, for example, we've taken quite differing points of view about whether the death penalty should be executed in other countries or not, whether we care about that, whether that's important. No, I know. This is what I was going to say. Australia's been monumentally hypocritical on the death penalty abroad. We will not extradite persons held here to death penalty jurisdictions, even our close ally, the United States, but we're also highly selective. We empathise with our fellow citizens and will campaign to save them, but fail to argue strongly enough for the general principle of opposition to the death penalty. Chan and Sukumaran had good reason to hope for clemency. They were exporting drugs from Indonesia, not taking them in. There was no contesting the evidence that they'd been dramatically rehabilitated in their decade in prison. Now, I was going to say that in the case of the execution of Amrozi and the two other Bali bombers in 2008, admittedly after an appalling crime involving scores of Australian lives lost, Kevin Rudd and John Howard both gave explicit support. And Stephen Smith, a more nuanced version. Simon Crean, a Labor leader, had been equivocal. Mark Latham supported John Howard on the execution of Saddam Hussein. So we haven't been completely level on this. Capital punishment is also, I think, a very interesting example of where elites, political, legal, judicial, medical, philosophical, creative elites, are probably well ahead of public feeling. Polling in Australia indicated the community was evenly divided over the fate of Chan and Sukumaran. The Ryan case in 1967 was an important factor in recruiting young people to political activism, perhaps second only to the Vietnam War. Nevertheless, Sir Henry Bolte cruised to victory in the Victorian election in 1967 and again in 1970. But of course, as I say, Bolte's successor was a convinced abolitionist, and it wasn't long before we moved in a completely different kind of direction. The opposition to the death penalty on, shall we say, on philosophical grounds goes back a very long time. In the 16th century, Michel de Montaigne, in his great essays, neatly set out his reasons for opposing the death penalty. He said, "Judgments normally inflame themselves towards revenge out of horror for the crime. That is precisely what tempers mine. My horror for the first murder makes me frightened of committing a second, and my loathing for the original act of cruelty makes me loathe to imitate it." And the great Milanese economist, Cesare Beccaria, in his famous book on crimes and punishment, published as early as 1764, argued for the abolition of the death penalty with a classic simplicity, and it had a mathematical basis, that there's no demonstrable correlation between the severity of punishment and the crime rate. All punishment deters, but there's no statistical evidence that execution or torture deters uniquely. Certainty of conviction is more likely to be an appropriate penalty. But of course, campaigners for abolition have to be prepared to argue for the tough cases, you know, repulsive as they are, Eichmann, Saddam Hussein, Eric Cook. The moral high ground doesn't allow campaigners to be selective. Leo Tolstoy saw a guillotining in Paris in 1857, and the image haunted him all his life. He said, "I witnessed many atrocities in the war and in the Caucasus, but I should have been less sickened to see a man torn to pieces before our eyes than I was by this perfected, elegant machine, by means of which a strong, clean, healthy man was killed in an instant. In the first case, there's no reasoning will, but a paroxysm of human passion. In the second, coolness to the point of refinement, homicide with comfort, nothing big. When I saw the head part from the body and each of them fall separately into a box with a thud, I understood, not in my mind but with my whole being, that no rational doctrine of progress could justify that act, and that if every man now living in the world and every man who'd lived since the beginning of time were to maintain, in the name of some theory or other, that this execution was indispensable, I should still know it was not indispensable, that it was wrong. Now, interesting that the United States, our very close ally, is leaving aside some of the Caribbean states, the only major democracy in the English-speaking world that still has the death penalty. But I think it's worth observing that the numbers are falling and that overwhelmingly the executions in the United States are essentially in the old Confederacy. See, for example, in the US in the year 2014, there were 35 executions, but in only 7 states of the US. And 2 of the states, Texas and Missouri, in 2 of the states, that's where the majority of the executions were. And so the result, and the only execution, there was one execution in Ohio, which was outside the old Confederacy. So essentially, it's been, the death penalty has in recent decades, in fact, since its restitution in 1977 in the United States, it's essentially been applied essentially in the states where once you had a long history of racism, of slavery, and of course, and lynch law as well. But there's no doubt it's quite a popular issue in several areas in the United States. Politicians are very nervous about saying that they oppose it because it's thought to be a sure vote loser. And with an election going like the election in the United States at the moment, you can't imagine anybody taking a line that's going to offend populist sensitivities. Well, I've had my 15 minutes. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Barry. It's always struck me that the importance actually of the conservative side of politics in this particular case. I recall in, I think it was 1989, when Australia pushed, to our credit, was the nation that resurrected the push for the second optional protocol, which was about the death penalty to the International Covenants on Political Rights. And it's not a well-known story, but in fact it was Ian Sinclair, leader of the National Party, who was very critical to us getting that fundamental agreement through the Australian Parliament at that time. Turning to the international domain, we have with us Professor Michael Head. Now, Michael is the co-director of research and higher degree research at the School of Law, and he's going to address the question with reference to the regional experience, including in Indonesia. Michael teaches law. You've been here for quite some time now, Michael, at this institution.
Yes. 18 years.
18 years. That's older than a lot of our audience, I'd have to suggest. You know. But Michael has made an extraordinary contribution in a number of ways. His books on public law, on socialist legal theory and civil and liberties, including his book Crimes Against the State, From Treason to Terrorism in 2011, and Emergency Powers in Theory and Practice, The Long Shadow of Carl Schmitt, and has written very, I think, in administrative law as well. Michael, is that not right?
Yes.
So a very diverse and very impressive legal background. And I think it's fair to say, in the very best of senses, that Michael is a consistent and long-standing public warrior. Welcome to the stage.
Thanks, Eric. When I was first asked to speak on the politics of the death penalty, one word immediately came to my mind, particularly in the light of the executions of Andrew Chan and Myuran Sukumaran on April the 28th. And that word is hypocrisy. Upon further reflection, two other words occurred to me as equally as important, at least in addressing the underlying issues at stake in the death penalty as a whole. And those words are inequality and repression. Let me explain. Who are the victims of the death penalty? And who have they been historically? Almost invariably, they fall into two categories. The first consists of the poor, the downtrodden, the disadvantaged, the mentally unwell, the drug addicted, and the vulnerable. In short, members of the working class. Take the United States as a prime example. As of August the 14th this year, there have been 1,413 executions carried out in that country since 1976, when the US Supreme Court reinstated the death penalty. The governments of that country, still the headquarters of world capitalism, execute more people per capita than most in the world. There are 3,000 people in America languishing on death row out of a population of 2.4 million prisoners in the United States, overwhelmingly poor and working class, and disproportionately African American and Latino. Here is just one case. In April this year, the state of Texas executed 42-year-old Kent Sprouse, the 11th person to be executed in the United States this year. His death by lethal injection took 22 minutes. In 2002, Sprouse had shot and killed two people outside a convenience store. One was a police officer, and that's the only charge brought forward against him. Evidence suggests that Sprouse was mentally ill and a drug addict. Witnesses at his trial testified that in the year leading up to the shooting, he had become increasingly delusional and began hearing voices. Sprouse had been admitted to a mental institution earlier that year, but was released after several days. America's execution toll does not count the growing numbers of poor and working class people killed by the police, which is a form of extrajudicial execution. In August 2014, Michael Brown, an unarmed black teenager, was shot in cold blood by a police officer in Ferguson, Missouri. In the year after that, despite widespread protests against the mounting deaths, over 1,100 people were shot by police, killed by police in the United States. Only a tiny fraction of the officers involved have been charged with any crime. Nor do the death penalty statistics count the thousands of victims of drone assassinations ordered by the US president, a death toll that includes at least three known US citizens. Between 2004 and 2015, the US killed as many as 3,949 people through drone strikes in Pakistan alone, according to the Bureau of Investigative Journalism. Now, that is another type of state murder, in which the president acts personally as judge, jury, and executioner, in violation of the US Constitution's requirements for due process. Such killings are not confined to the United States. On Monday this week, Britain's Prime Minister David Cameron informed Parliament that some months ago he authorised the extrajudicial murder via drone attacks of three British citizens in Syria. In April, The Australian reported for the first time that an Australian citizen, Mustafa Farag, was placed on the Obama administration's kill list for assassination by drone attack. Now, this brings me to the second category of victims of the death penalty, those executed specifically for political reasons, usually because they've been regarded as threats to the ruling establishment. They've been mostly socialists, independence fighters, or opponents of war, or deserters of war. In World War I, 306 British and Commonwealth soldiers were executed by firing squads for alleged crimes such as desertion and cowardice. Some were as young as 16. The executions increased as the full horrors of the war unfolded. Many of those who were executed are believed to have been suffering from what came to be called shell shock and then post-traumatic shock syndrome. Historically, one of the most barbaric instances was the mass execution of the Communards, who had formed the Paris Commune in 1871, which was the first attempt by the emerging working class to overthrow the capitalist state and form a new government, form their own government. During and after the military suppression of the Commune, somewhere between 7,000 and 20,000 Communards and their supporters or family members were murdered, mostly put up against walls and shot. Another notorious example was the Moscow trials of 1937 to 1938, conducted by the Stalinist bureaucracy in the Soviet Union. Often falsely depicted as the product of communism, these trials were in fact the opposite, the extermination of genuine Marxists, including all the leaders of the October 1917 Russian Revolution, by the privileged caste that usurped political power in the first workers' state. Following preposterous show trials, thousands were summarily executed. The prime target of those trials, convicted to death in absentia, was Leon Trotsky, who had formed the left opposition and then the Fourth International to fight the Stalinist regime and reassert true communism. Trotsky was ultimately murdered by one of Stalin's KGB agents in Mexico City 75 years ago this year in August 1940. Now, whether the apparatus of the state is directed against political opponents or victims of the social crisis that afflicts contemporary capitalism, its essential and underlying purpose is the same: the preservation of the power of the financial elite. There was a revealing historical echo this March when the Utah governor, Gary Herbert, signed into law a bill reinstating the firing squad as a method of execution. Fittingly, the announcement came in the run-up to the centenary of the execution of the revolutionary Labour activist and songwriter Joe Hill. Born Joe Emanuel Hägglund in Sweden, Hill immigrated to the US and became an organiser for the IWW, the Industrial Workers of the World. He was executed by a Utah firing squad on November the 19th, 1915, after a frame-up murder conviction. Of course, members of the IWW were also framed up in Australia in the same period, including by a Labour government. Hill's fate underscores the fact that capital punishment and other forms of state coercion and repression are directed above all against the working class and its revolutionary potential. The barbarity of the state apparatus expresses the interest that it represents. The corporate and financial oligarchy, whose wealth is increasingly derived from speculation and financial manipulations, standing on top of a society driven by historically unprecedented levels of inequality. In the words of Frederick Engels, the state consists in its essence of special bodies of armed men and prisons and institutions of coercion of all kinds. This apparatus is, quote, the state of the most powerful, economically dominant class, a means of holding down and exploiting the oppressed class. Now, allow me to turn back to the words I used at the beginning, hypocrisy. By this I mean the hypocrisy of governments, ruling classes and political parties, like those in Australia, who now formally oppose the death penalty, but are quite prepared to embrace its continued practice by their closest allies, such as the United States, or regimes with which they are seeking to establish profitable or strategic relations, such as China and Indonesia. Yes, it's true, the death penalty has not been inflicted in Australia since the vindictive and wrongful execution of Ronald Ryan in 1967, but that is largely the result of popular opposition and revulsion towards the death penalty, not any belated discovery by the political establishment of a sense of social justice or human dignity. It's also true that Australian law no longer provides for the death penalty and supposedly places a limit on the capacity of the authorities to extradite people from Australia to face possible execution. However, as the executions of Chan and Sukumaran demonstrate all too clearly, these policies and restrictions are readily thrust aside when required by the predatory interests of the Australian elite. On April the 28th, Indonesian authorities carried out the execution by firing squad of 8 people convicted of drug offences, the 2 Australian citizens, as well as 4 Nigerians, a Brazilian and an Indonesian. This ruthless act provoked widespread popular opposition in Australia. But the fact that Chan and Sukumaran faced the firing squad is a direct responsibility of the Australian Federal Police. Rather than making arrests in Australia, the AFP provided detailed information to its Indonesian counterparts, knowing full well that the Australian citizens could face the death penalty. Chan and Sukumaran were, along with 7 so-called drug mules, the so-called Bali Nine, were arrested in 2005 as they were leaving to return to Australia. The father of one of those detained, Scott Rush, had alerted the AFP to the drug smuggling plan before the 9 had even left Australia to go to Bali. And he was reassured by the police that his son would be stopped from departing, a promise the AFP did not keep. A decade later, the AFP guidelines continued to allow Australian police to collaborate with police forces in Indonesia and other countries in cases that could lead to the death penalty. According to the Fairfax Media, in the past 5 years alone, the AFP has given foreign police forces the names of 1,847 people who, as a result, could face the death penalty. These figures, obtained via Freedom of Information requests, show that police grant about 93% or more of requests for help from police forces in death penalty countries. Where people are already arrested by police in a death penalty jurisdiction, the Justice Minister must sign off on the help being provided by the AFP. The vast majority of those cases have also been approved. So it's not just the policy of the AFP, it is the policy of the political establishment itself. Guidelines introduced in 2009 after the public outcry over the Bali Nine case require police to consider the likelihood of the person being subject to the death penalty when cooperating with a foreign police force. However, that is just one of many considerations, including Australia's interest in promoting cooperation with foreign authorities. A dozen Australians, including 2 grandmothers, are on death row currently, 9 in China. Police have said that in the past that none of the 12 on death row were there because of AFP intervention, but under both Coalition and Labor governments, the AFP has signed memoranda of understanding with police forces in Singapore, Malaysia, Vietnam, Japan, China, and the United States, as well as Indonesia, all of which impose the death penalty. The AFP's secret agreement with the Indonesian police was sealed in 2002 in the wake of the Bali bombings, which claimed the lives of 202 people, including 88 Australians. Since then, the two police forces have established extensive relations in a range of areas, including counter-terrorism, so-called, and joint efforts to prevent refugees reaching Australia from Indonesia by boat. The fraudulent character of the campaign against capital punishment in recent months is highlighted by the record of both Labor and Liberal leaders on the death penalties meted out to the perpetrators of the 2002 Bali bombings. And Barry, in fact, referred to this earlier. Not only did John Howard, the Coalition Prime Minister in 2003, declare there won't be any protests from Australia if they were executed, the Labor Prime Minister in 2008, Kevin Rudd, insisted that the men deserve the justice that will be delivered to them. Now, this year, of course, within weeks of the execution of Chan and Sukumaran, the Abbott government, with the full support of the Labor Party, declared it was time to move on. For all the confected displeasure, for all the crocodile tears displayed towards Jakarta, none of the establishment parties, and this includes the Greens, will upset the economic and strategic ties with Indonesia. The government has ruled out any change in police and military ties with Jakarta and assured the corporate elite that it will not compromise on trade and investment. As far as Canberra is concerned, and more importantly Washington, Indonesia is a vital link in the US pivot to Asia, so-called, and its military build-up in this region, particularly against China. As a socialist and as a Marxist, I agree with the Enlightenment principle of hostility and opposition to arbitrary state violence, which was associated with the Ancien regime and the feudal aristocracy of Europe. To quote the Italian philosopher Cesare Beccaria, who Barry also referred to, a leading figure of the Enlightenment, he wrote the following in his famous book On Crimes and Punishments in 1764. What must men think when they see wise magistrates and grave ministers of justice with indifference and tranquility dragging a criminal to death? And whilst a wretch trembles with agony, expecting the fatal stroke, the judge who has condemned him with the coldest insensibility and perhaps with no small gratification from the exertion of his authority quits his tribunal to enjoy the comforts and pleasures of life. The continued practice of the death penalty is a symptom of a deeply diseased society, corrupted through and through by social inequality and the aristocratic principle that the wealthy and the powerful can do whatever they want, while the poor and the powerless are to be humiliated and degraded. For these reasons, as a Marxist, I unconditionally oppose the death penalty.
Thank you very much, Michael. I suspect it's an address that some in the audience are unused to, and it's of a great service to us, indeed, that there is more to politics and the understanding of politics than simply one point of view. It's critical that we actually engage, I think, in the broader and deeper analyses of what is driving these sorts of issues in our political life. So we're very indebted to you. Thank you. It's now the turn of Catherine Renshaw, who follows on to a couple of big papers, eh? Catherine, I should say firstly, has done a fantastic service. Not only is she a terrific colleague in the School of Law, but originally, you might recall, Andrea Durbach was billed to speak this evening, but Andrea, for a range of reasons, just couldn't make it, and Catherine, stood up to the mark and is here with us this evening. Catherine herself, I can tell you, comes with a very fine background and pedigree in terms of addressing these issues. She's a senior lecturer in the School of Law here. Her research focuses on human rights and democracy in Southeast Asia, and she's well published with Professor Ben Saul as editor of the Human Rights in Asia and the Pacific, which was a 2014 book. She was formerly deputy director of the Australia-Myanmar Constitutional Democracy Project based at Sydney University, and continues as a convener of a number of workshops centred on constitutional reform in the lead up to Myanmar's elections, general elections in this very year. Catherine this evening is actually going to draw on that background in the international world and to look at international human rights, the human rights movement, in achieving change over the past half century and political responses to international activism more broadly. Catherine Renshaw.
Thank you, Eric. It's an absolute honour to share a platform with Barry Jones. And after hearing Michael Head talk, it's an absolute honour to share a platform with Michael, and you, of course, Eric.
I was waiting.
It's an honour to share a platform with
those. Someone impatiently, I was waiting.
So, as Eric mentioned, I'm going to talk about the politics of the death penalty from the perspective of international human rights law. The problem with the death penalty from an international human rights law perspective is that it undercuts and violates the right to life. And the right to life is the fundamental, sacrosanct cornerstone of all other rights. If there is a hierarchy of human rights, then it's the right to life that stands at the pinnacle of that. It's one of the few norms of international law that's jus cogens. It's a fundamental overriding principle. No state can deny it or derogate from it. So it's in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. We've got Article 3. Everyone has the right to life, liberty, security of person. It's in the big international covenants, the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights. Every human being has an inherent right to life. It's protected by law. No one can be arbitrarily deprived of his life. So at the broadest level, a human rights approach against the death penalty doesn't take issue with the accuracy or the technique or the timeliness of executions. It's a strict standard that says violating the right to life is wrong. But from a human rights perspective, there are also specific problems with the application of the death penalty. One of them is that it violates other basic human rights, like the right not to be tortured and the prohibition against cruel and inhuman and degrading treatment. So the death row phenomenon, for example, is said to constitute a breach of the prohibition against torture. The death row phenomenon is that combination of circumstances to which a prisoner is exposed in solitary confinement for many years in a 6 by 9 foot cell if they're in America under sentence of death. The psychological repercussions of this constitute torture in international human rights law. So it's not the death penalty itself that's cruel and inhuman, it's the practice of the death penalty. The other human rights principle that the death penalty violates is the principle against discrimination, for a lot of the reasons that Michael talked about, because the certain groups against whom the death penalty is applied tend to be racial minorities. They tend to be people from a particular socioeconomic group. And there's rigorous research about this, mainly coming out of the United States. All the studies show that the odds of receiving a death sentence are 4 times as high if the defendant is black. And that's after controlling for case differences like the severity of the crime and the background of the defendant. Other studies have tried to explain why this is the case, and it's also a blindingly simple answer. The key decision makers, the prosecutors, the judges, and sometimes even the juries in death penalty cases, are almost exclusively white men. But tonight we're not really talking about the law of the death penalty as much as about the politics of it. And it's since the Second World War, the international human rights movement has made a big contribution to propelling abolitionism. It's done this in some of the ways I've described. Firstly, by framing the death penalty as an assault on the most basic principle, the right to life. And secondly, by providing universal standards against torture and non-discrimination against which the actual application of the death penalty can be measured. The problem is that human rights law is not unequivocally against the death penalty. Like all human rights, the right to life itself is not absolute. Obvious exception, self-defense. You've got the right to take the life of another person if your own life is threatened. So in international human rights law, we envisage that some states will maintain the death penalty. And what the duty of the state is, it's a negative duty, not to put someone to death unless there's a legal basis for the killing. So the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights tries to spell out circumstances where killing is justified. Only for the most serious crimes, in accordance with law, anyone sentenced to death has to have the right to appeal. Death won't be imposed for crimes committed by a person when they were under the age of 18. Death sentence won't be carried out on pregnant women, those sorts of things. And it's here that international human rights law really begins to unravel a bit in how useful it is as a tool. Because two of the greatest challenges to international human rights law come to the fore. One of them is relativism. What's a most serious crime for which a state can put someone to death? It depends on the history, on the society, and the culture of that particular state. It's what most deeply affronts the fabric of a particular society, breaches that society's mores and values. We here in Australia think murder is that, the taking of life. But in other countries, other things are most serious crimes, and we know from what Michael said that in Indonesia, drug trafficking is held to be the most serious of crimes. It afflicts the moral fibre of the Indonesian nation. And the second big way that the international human rights project against the death penalty unravels is on the issue of sovereignty, because we still respect to a significant degree the rights of a state to determine what happens to its own citizens. Just on the point of what different states regard as most serious crimes, in China, there are things like arson, burglary, economic crimes, treason and military offences. In Egypt, after the fall of President Mubarak, the Supreme Council expanded the range of crimes that were capital crimes, the death penalty attached to them, to include hooliganism, thuggery. In Iran, the list is even longer. The recidivist consumption of alcoholic beverages, fornication by unmarried persons, extramarital sexual relations between non-Muslim men and Muslim women, all of these are things to which the death penalty attaches. In Vietnam, bribery and embezzlement are crimes punishable by death. Several of the countries that I just mentioned have actually ratified the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. So clearly, getting a country to sign up to an international human rights treaty is not a good political weapon in all circumstances. Why we human rights lawyers think ratification is important is because it brings states within an international human rights law world where they're required to justify their actions to a community of states, to explain how their policies and laws conform to international standards. And what we hope is that as a result of these processes of explanation and justification, where other actors and NGOs and civil society are able to put their views, that eventually the mindset of the states change. But the real end game is what's been already referred to by Eric, and that's getting states to sign up to the second optional protocol of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. That was added in 1989. It's optional. States don't have to agree to it when they sign up to the principal covenant, but what it does is it prohibits the death penalty. And cunningly, it also contains no exit mechanism. So once a country has signed the second optional protocol, they can never withdraw from it. So Australia's signed it, Indonesia hasn't, though Indonesia's signed the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. I suppose a state could breach international law and carry out an execution even after it's signed a treaty saying that it won't. But states generally don't like to breach international law. Two areas I'll finish on where there has been success from international human rights law in advancing the case of abolition are through the work of regional human rights systems, which tend to be stronger and have more provisions for enforcement than the global UN system does. So in the Americas, there's also a protocol to the American Convention on Human Rights, and 13 out of the 22 states have signed that optional protocol that prohibits the death penalty among states that are parties to the American Convention. The United States is obviously not one of them, but neither is Canada, though Canada has abolished the death penalty. In Europe, the abolition of the death penalty is a prerequisite for EU membership. The death penalty is held to be cruel and inhuman and not to act as a deterrent to crime. So the European Union forbids companies, for example, from exporting to the United States, for example, chemicals that might be used in carrying out executions within the United States. The EU has also insisted that bilateral extradition treaties contain provisions that mean the death penalty won't be applied. Which, of course, brings us to the case of Julian Assange. And his claims that one of the reasons why he needs to seek asylum in the Ecuadorian embassy is because the US could extradite him from Britain or Sweden, if he went there, to the United States. And in the United States, he could face the death penalty for crimes committed under the Espionage Act. There is indeed a provision for the death penalty to be applied under federal law for crimes committed under the Espionage Act. It hasn't been used since the end of the Cold War in America. But the point is that Britain and Sweden would not breach EU law to extradite an Australian citizen to the United States in circumstances where he could face the death penalty. It's inconceivable that they would do that. But Julian Assange is an untrusting sort of fellow, and perhaps he's right not to entirely trust international law. The third major treaty is the African Charter on Human and People's Rights, which contains a right to life and many African states have abolished the death penalty, but more have not. A leader in this field is the South African Constitutional Court. It was the very first case decided by the South African Constitutional Court. It ended the death penalty in a country that was had one of the world's highest rates of capital punishment. And for all the reasons that Michael talked about, the death penalty was applied as a tool of terror to keep a majority black population subservient to the minority white population. So the first decision of a new South African court abolishing the death penalty was political and historic. The Arab Charter of Human Rights is of no use whatsoever in relation to abolishing the death penalty because it is subservient to Sharia law, and Sharia law has as part of its premise the application of the death penalty for committing religious crimes. And I really will finish on this one now, but the final way that international law works is in peace agreements or when the United Nations is involved in countries transitioning from authoritarian regimes to democracy, it often insists on a provision in a new constitution or a peace agreement that the death penalty will no longer be part of the new order. And that works well. In Cambodia, for example, the abolition of the death penalty served to distinguish the murderous regime of Pol Pot from the new order. And a contrary example is the execution of Saddam Hussein, which we've heard a bit about already, after a domestic trial largely funded by the United States. The execution of Hussein contributed, of course, to the rise of ISIS. And last year, the Kurdish judge who sentenced Saddam Hussein to death was himself executed by ISIS in retaliation for that. So I suppose the point of ending on that note is to say, as all of the speakers have, that the death penalty doesn't serve the cause of justice.
Catherine, thanks very much. In fact, it was a fine way to actually wrap up this part of the discussion this evening. And I think what becomes clear if you listen to our three speakers is that for all our sense that the issue is settled, and many of us would like to think that it is settled in Australia, it is still a deep and complex series of interrelated issues, not only in terms of what is happening elsewhere, but in terms of how our own governments relate to what's happening elsewhere in terms of some sort of consistent policy. So I think it was a really excellent way to canvas the range of those issues and introduce them to us with a very disciplined group of people who all kept to 15 minutes. Could you please thank our panellists? I rather foolishly have on the program here on my run sheet to say that it's my obligation to wrap up. But I think it would not be justice to the three speakers for me to pretend that there's some simple way that they can be reconciled. But of course, quite clearly, as it should be, they're quite different, almost radically different points of view being presented to us around the contextual arrangements that lead to the issues, whether it's the death penalty or other things, and hence the importance of actually having public discourse. I would say, though, if I could indulge just a little bit, that and to draw on a little bit of experience, that it is possible, even in areas where we have radically different points from which we start, to come to points that on some issues we find concurrence and actually can induce and encourage and, in fact, achieve change. And I'd suggest if we step back a little bit on this particular issue, we will see that what seemed insurmountable in the abolition of death penalty in this country at various times, in fact, proved to be surmountable through different people with very radically different perspectives coming together at least on that. I recall I was struck by your question about relativism and about how do you pick it out. And I'll simply say that in 1983, it was the World Conference on Human Rights, and there was a huge debate at that time. And the debate was about relativism and human rights. And in the Asian Pacific region, the regional assembly of the United Nations conference, what happened there was remarkable because a number of the Asian governments, a number of which have been mentioned tonight, had actually tried to suggest that human rights were not applicable because they were Western and imposed. Yeah. But at that particular forum, unprecedented, there were 240 non-government organisations gathered from around the region who met for 3 days before the UN meeting, who agreed amongst themselves from radically different non-government organisations from all different sorts of cultures and societies. Hundreds were there, met for 3 days, and over those 3 days agreed on a common platform that they would be taking to the governmental meeting because we had rights to address that meeting. And every single person who spoke at the governmental meeting over the next days from the NGOs stood and spoke with the same opening words, which were agreed by the group, which were, I rise to speak on behalf of 240 non-government organisations from the Asia and Pacific region. And effectively what they did was put paid to the relativism debate in Asia on the human rights and the human rights mechanisms. And I simply cite it to say that things are possible, things can be great things, can be achieved through our activities as citizens, as thinking citizens, and I would say to our young people, as powerful citizens when we are organised and thoughtful and apply that to the politics of our own country. So I would encourage you to do so, and I'm certainly encouraged by the fact that you've all come here tonight to participate in another Whitlam Institute and Law School event. Thank you.